What I'd like to do is I'd like to give you just a few sentences about the European Roundtable, because this is a new initiative that we're running in Brussels, and I give you a little bit of a background. My feeling was that the work that I had been doing for the last number of years, I wanted very much to continue it. And I thought very hard about exactly how, in what form. And the conclusion was more or less that it was very important that we continue to focus on climate change, but we also wanted to focus on what it is, the period of transition. Because this is what we're managing here, is the period of transition, a transition to low carbon economy. And how that transition is being managed is extremely important. This is why we ended up with a very, very long name, because somebody said we needed European in there because we didn't know what it was. And then we wanted climate change and sustainable transition, so we ended up with ERCST. I think it's hard, and in time, I hope you'll remember it. It took me a little bit of time to remember ICTSD, but I think I got it now. And I hope you will get used to ERCST, because I hope you'll come to the meetings. The one thing that I wanted to make sure is that in these meetings and in this new initiative, we had a very good representation of different countries and different organizations. And as such, we reach out to many of the people in business that has been with us for a while. And you know, I'm not going to go through the list, but they are here in the room, and I'm very grateful to them for continuing to support. But we also started to reach out to member states, and we, you know, I can only do so much at one time, so we reached out to some of the member states that I've done a lot of work in the past. So I've reached out to Carsten Zach in Berlin at the ministry, and he was very supportive, and Germany, the BMUB is part of this. We reached out to the Polish Minister of Foreign Affairs. Poland is an important player in Europe, and an important player in the climate change policy in Europe, and to France. And then we've done a lot of work with France. It doesn't mean now that we will be neglecting others, but we have to start somewhere. We also reach out to a number of important organizations in Europe, and again, I'm very gratified by the fact that they have been supportive. I think they are in the room, it's Confindustria and BDI and AFEP, so the big federations around Europe. And finally, we also reached out, as you may have seen, to put together a scientific advisory committee. And it's you know, people that I think I have a lot of respect for, and people that will be able to guide us and keep us on the straight line. Ricardo Melendez Ortiz, who is the head of ICTSD, but also Teresa Ribera from IDRI, the former state secretary, Carlo Carraro from FEM, Susana Droge from SWP, Dr. Schleicher, who is here from the Wegener Center, and Professor Lieberberg from SER. So it's quite an eminent bunch of people that are around this organization now, and hopefully will keep us honest and straight. Now, coming back to where we're here, one of the things that, you know, kind of what do you do your first launch? What do you do your first meeting with? And everybody's doing ETS right now in town. Everybody's trying to get a piece of Ian Duncan and Federley. And I think that's very laudable, and I'll try and get a piece of them as well. But I'm really an internationalist, and if you want, a multilateralist at heart. And I still think that what we achieved in Paris was extremely important, because it really underpins what we're going to be doing from here on. And this is going to be the building block and the framework on which we're going to move forward. So we are now a year after Paris, almost a year after Paris. We still remember, I think, the times of going to Paris. And preparing ourselves, and frankly, we didn't know what we could expect. But we came out with a great success. I still remember the morning after, if you want to call it that, and you know, it was a beautiful day in Warsaw, working down Champs-Élysées with Thomas Khrushchev, and saying, well, actually, we did it. And it was a really nice feeling. So, you know, one of the things that I've tried to do over the years is to bring the international dimension to Brussels. Brussels is, like many of the capitals, is a quintessential inward-looking place, which people are very preoccupied with European affairs. This is what Brussels is. People are working for European affairs most of the time. But I think that in the climate change domain, we need to remember that it is placed in a global context. And that global context is within the UNFCCC negotiation process. And we are now preparing to go to Marrakech for COP22. That's why I was also very fortunate that I could be joined for this panel by people that have been involved in this process for a long time, people that have been quite instrumental in the negotiations. Many of them have worn different hats over the years, and now continue to play a very important role. And again, I'm very gratified that you have taken the time to come here. Now, Dr. Ricardo Melendez-Ortiz is somewhere landing or has landed from Geneva. EasyJet is usually a very unpredictable type of thing, and as such, he will be here, but you know, he's on his way somehow. But starting from that side, we have Jake Swartzman, who is the principal advisor to the Director General for Climate Action. And I don't know, I think of him as kind of leading the EU delegation when he goes to, probably that's what you do. Anyway, somebody that I've known for many years in many capacity, he's been at WRI, he's teaching, and I've learned to respect. We don't always necessarily agree, but I certainly have a healthy dose of respect for his logic and what he brings. Next on my right is a good friend and an old friend, Dirk Forrester, who is the CEO of AIDA. Dirk is known to many of you as being one of the people that has the institutional memory. He has been working in the White House. He has worked for environmental defense, I believe, and now he has he's worked for NatSource, where he actually has done business and trying to do transactions and run funds. And now he's been, for the last number of years, the CEO of AIDA. So I'm very happy, Dirk, that we with your busy schedule, you could also be here. On my left, you have Joe Tindall. Joe is the co-chair of the APA, the Ad Hoc Working Group on the Paris Agreement. She was New Zealand's climate change ambassador and head of the delegation of the at the negotiation with the Minister of Trade and Foreign Affairs and Trade. She is a very experienced negotiator. I think that Joe sitting in the chair with Sarah chairing the APA is a very powerful duo. Frankly, I don't have to negotiate in front of the APA, but I would be very, very careful if I did in terms of what I say and what I break the rules. But Joe, thank you very much for coming here. I think that your experience from the past in one seat and now in this current position you have is going to be very interesting. Finally, to my left is Tomas Khrushchev. He's the chair of the subsidiary body for implementation. Tomas has been around this process and climate change and environment for many years. I have met him first as the director of the Glass Association in Poland, and then one day I ran into him at the meeting and he said, and I'm a director in the Ministry of Environment in Poland. I said, why not? And Thomas then has become has become one of the leading negotiators, certainly representing Poland. Being in the chair of SBI for a number of turns at SAPSTA, and then also working for the Polish presidency when they did the COP in Warsaw. And I had the pleasure to work with Tomas as part of my tradition of working with P countries. So I work with Poland in that situation and working with Tomas and for Tomas. So this is kind of where we are. The idea today is to talk about COP22 coming from Paris expectations. What are the expectations? I mean, everybody has different level of expectation, but what is the outlook? There was a meeting last week in Rabat, informal head of delegation meeting, and the first morning was about expectation and what different delegation had expectations. But also, what I wanted is to introduce the dimension, if you want, the dimension of the of trade. And how trade impacts and is impacted by these negotiations. Because I do regard this agreement as being a worrying about the environment and about kind of not being this hot outside. But in the end, if you look at this at the Kyoto Protocol, if you look at the Paris Agreement, it's about technology and intellectual property, technology transfer and finance. So these are really trade agreements by and large. It tells you what your competitor will do and how they will do it. And that's supposed to create a trust between parties and implicitly be the people that are behind the parties, all the stakeholders in different countries. And that's why I think the trade dimension in all this is very important. ICTSD, of course, is an organization that is very well known and very knowledgeable on issues of trade agreements, sustainable developments. It's based in Geneva. A lot, you know, they're doing a lot of work with all the WTO ambassadors. So it's an angle, it's a new thing that I haven't been doing too much in the past, but I'm very happy. And Ricardo will be here. He's the person that can talk to this until you guys get fed up. But I'm not that person. So anyway, we're complementary. So what I'd like to do now, I'd like to start in a way from the more general to the kind of particolare, if I can. And Joe, you are the chair of the APA. I just wanted you to talk through these three things, kind of the expectation, outlook, but also how do you see this impacting the discussion on different trade things that are going on, because you are also a very knowledgeable person in the trade area. Joe Tindall.
Thanks very much, Andre, and it's great to be here in this rather lovely building. Thank you for coming along tonight. I don't know whether I'm going to cover everything you wanted me to, but I've certainly got a few things to say. What I wanted to start with was noting that there's a debate begun amongst the science community about whether we're entering the world is entering a new age, dubbed the Anthropocene age, which I guess is defined by human influence on the natural world. And within that, climate change is clearly front and center. I think it's seen as a risk amplifier for a world that is becoming increasingly concerned about scarcity of natural resources, particularly in terms of food security, water security, energy security. So climate change, a risk amplifier for all of those. Now, I think the scientists are going to debate this, as they do, for a while yet. But it does put the Paris Agreement into a rather large context. Andre's already referred to that historic, if not euphoric, moment in Paris last year. But that moment, of course, was not the end. In many respects, the work is just beginning. So there's various people, I guess, have various jobs from now. The job for governments is to get on with ratifications so that the agreement can formally enter into force, and also to design the policies, the regulatory frameworks that are going to allow them to meet their targets, their so-called INDCs, intended nationally determined contributions. With the I now dropping off, they are nationally determined contributions. The job for negotiators is to sort out what I guess is known as the Paris rulebook, the MPGs, we love our acronyms, and the UNFCCC, the modalities, procedures and guidelines that are going to put the flesh on the bones of the Paris Agreement. What the agreement makes clear, though, is that it's not just incremental change, it's transformative change, it's disruptive technologies that are going to be needed to get to where we want to go in terms of the goal of the agreement, the 2-degree goal or the 1.5-degree goal that are both encapsulated in there. And to get to that goal and to achieve that transformative change, it's going to need partnerships, not just government at a government level. It's also going to involve cities, business, the financial sector, and so on and so on. And I think in all those areas, as Andre's already alluded, there are enormous implications for trade and for every economy around the world. The atmosphere in Paris was indeed, it was euphoric. It was fantastic moment to be there. And there's always, I suppose you could call it post-purchase dissonance when it comes to people going to COPs, agreeing something, and then getting back together next year and thinking, well, did we really agree that? Or I thought I agreed something. No, you thought it was something else. But I've been to numerous meetings this year, and the political momentum, that buy-in to the Paris Agreement, has not diminished at all. In fact, it's possibly grown. There's been a kind of constructive spirit in evidence at every meeting this year. Paris, as we know, delivered a really fine balance between so-called bottom-up flexibility that's around the whole idea of national determination according to circumstances and capacities, and the top-down. The top-down being the obligations or expectations that are needed to put some parameters around what would otherwise be a complete free-for-all. And I guess is the raison d'etre of having a multilateral agreement. So those parameters, the top-down aspect of what's needed for consistency, for coherence, and for credibility of the Paris Agreement. Everybody is expected to do what works for them, but at the same time, there's an expectation or a requirement to tell the rest of the world what you're doing in respect of the things for which you are responsible. And there's a very strong relationship between transparency, accountability, being held to account for what you're doing, and ambition. And all those three components are on the agenda for the APA, for which I'm responsible. Just a very quick word on trade, and I'm not going to focus on this. I'll get back to the APA. But on trade, the 5 yearly cycles for NDCs mean there is going to be regular progression or increased ambition on the part of all those UNFCCC parties. And I think about 90 of the INDCs tabled last year indicated either a clear intention or at least preserved an option to use market mechanisms, carbon market mechanisms, to help achieve their targets. It's pretty clear that demand, with all parties taking targets, demand is going to grow. And as low-hanging fruit, in terms of mitigation, climate mitigation, gets harvested at home, the more we're going to see countries turn to the kinds of cooperation that are envisaged in Article 6 of the Paris Agreement. And also, I think the traditional north-south roles of buyers versus sellers is going to disappear. And you'll see a whole new set of forms of linking, as well as, and I think you're already seeing in North America, national markets being built from the bottom up at a state level and then being networked. Now, there's a lot of talk about implementation. You know, we've had Paris, now we've got to walk the talk. But what does that mean? And I just want to point out that it's not just a case of domestic regulation and action agenda initiatives. I'm a big proponent of the Paris rulebook being an absolutely critical part at all phases of the process. So just what do I mean by the phases? At the front end, ex ante, it's a question of getting some clarity around the information to be provided, the accounting approaches that countries and governments are going to use, how things might be adjusted for the land sector, emissions and removals, and for use of carbon markets. During that 5 yearly cycle of NDCs, what the Paris rulebook is focused on is transparency. And by that, of course, I mean reporting on your greenhouse gas emissions and how you're tracking towards achievement of your targets. And it's about review of each party's report. Afterwards, ex post, there are a couple of aspects, and it's debatable whether it's ex post or during. During, you also have the global stock takes, a regular assessment of collectively how we are getting on and how we are making progress towards achieving those core goals of the Paris Agreement. After the fact, ex post, the key issue is compliance. We are bound to design a facilitative compliance mechanism, but we don't know exactly what that means. And it's also about the renewal process of a next cycle of NDCs. Now, the modalities, procedures and guidelines that we'll need will then need to be backed up by domestic systems, and that's going to increasingly involve non-state actors. As we start looking into how we get better transparency, not only of action taken, but also of support, financial and other support provided and received. It's going to involve non-state actors when we're tracking how we're collectively progressing with mitigation targets, with actions to adapt to the impacts of climate change, and with respect to finance and support that's provided, especially as we are turning increasingly to mobilisation of finance from the private sector with public sector finance leveraging a lot of support. There are linkages not only within the APA agenda but also across into the work of other bodies, including, for example, the work Tomasz's group is doing in the subsidiary body on implementation, and in the work that Andre has been following closely on Article 6, the carbon markets work. So as I said, just to bring this to a conclusion, the political momentum is really good. There's a race on to ratify the agreement, and the expectations now, contrary to where people's thinking was ahead of Paris, the expectations now is that the agreement could well meet that threshold for formal entry into force by the end of this year. What that means is that if it happens, it'll beat the completion of the Paris rulebook, probably by some considerable period of time. Just taking one example, the expectation is for the APA to complete work on the transparency framework, the modalities, procedures and guidelines for transparency, by the end of 2018. Well, we're going to have to work out how things operate if the agreement has entered into force before we've finished that job. Now, Paris gave us the broad parameters, the skeleton, if you like, of the new climate regime, and it settled where we stand on that very core political issue of, it is the longest acronym, I think, in the UNFCCC acronym, CBDRRCILDNC, which stands for Common but Differentiated Responsibilities and Respective Capabilities in Light of Different National Circumstances. And that is the phrase we have enshrined in the Paris Agreement. So having settled where we stand on that, the political heat has been turned down, unlike the heat in this room. But I want to sort of put a note of caution out. Of course, the fault lines that were there before Paris haven't miraculously all gone away. And I think I used a couple of days ago a bit of an analogy to cooking shows, where the contestants may often be given a box of exactly the same ingredients, but what they come up with by way of dishes is radically different. So I think that's a bit of a situation that we'll find ourselves in as we try and settle on these modalities, procedures and guidelines. It won't be completely straightforward. Now, the APA met for the very first time in May this year. Our second meeting will be at Marrakech, where we, along with the other bodies, will have a mere 6 days to negotiate. And in our case, in the APA's case, we have 5 very substantive agenda items, many with sub-items, to discuss. Now, we as co-chairs want parties to come ready to get to work. They should be taking Paris as a given, not seeking to relitigate it. And they must start focusing on the technical implementation. What I'm hoping is that they will come being clear about the essential questions to be resolved. What is the scope of the job we have ahead of us? And to scope out the broad options that are going to be available to help us find the middle ground, the solution on the Paris rulebook. And the final thing I think it's going to be important to do in Marrakech is to work out what's the best way to organise our work in 2017 so we can deliver in a timely way on the Paris rulebook. If we're indeed in the Anthropocene age, I think we have a huge responsibility to ensure it's not the Earth's last era. So I'll stop there.
Thank you, Joe. Now what I'll do is I'll go to, this is a kind of the scale here. Thomas is chairing the subsidiary body for implementation with one of the two subsidiary bodies of the convention, and he's got under his, if you want, under his chairmanship, a number of items that are interesting, some of them dealing with... It looks like a little robot. It's got a number of things, some of them dealing with markets, and it got a number of items dealing with markets, but it's also got a number of issues dealing with transition and that have competitive implications. So Thomas, again, the same thing. What are the Paris? What is the expectation? What is the outlook? What do you think you can do in Marrakech?
Okay,
by the way, Thomas, just 1 second. A couple of things that I forgot to say at the beginning. I apologize, Thomas. One of them is that there is a cocktail after this, so don't run away. If you run away, you lose the cocktail. And there's a certain Joss Delbecque who's going to come and say a few words, so we're very happy to have Joss. And also the fact that the other organizations have also come around us, including environmental organizations such as the Carbon Market Watch. Thomas,
yes, please. Okay, thank you. Thank you very much, Andre. I cannot compete with Joss Delbecque, so the announcement of his participation is obviously...
He has 5 points always.
Obviously, the cream de la cream of the meeting. Colleagues, let me first say that your five-letter acronym is not the longest I have seen. Joe mentioned the newest creation of climate thinkers. Well, the UNFCCC itself is longer, not to mention others. So this is very much in line of getting kind of lenient in our considerations of climate change and what needs to be done. And as a matter of fact, what happened in Paris last year, and what will be happening in Marrakech this year, is the conversation about, not about what needs to be done, because we all know what needs to be done. We need to be aware of the consequences of human activity. We need to be aware of the consequences of using the resources, of transforming them in industrial processes, of exploring and exploiting new areas of agrable land. We all know that. There was one thing that we didn't know. We didn't know how to work together on that. And Paris gave us the hope. And my reading of Paris Agreement is that we have agreed to work together. We have agreed that we will not restrict to just one way of addressing the problem, but we have agreed that we have to do it collectively. We have agreed that each of us, and I'm saying us not only thinking of countries, but literally of each of us, will do best we can do to reduce our own impact on environment, our own impact on climate. It's a lot in lifestyle, it's a lot in behavior, everyday behavior. And as Joe mentioned, this traditional nexus of water, energy, food security, I think that it's a new nexus that is now being created, the nexus of climate action, sustainable development, just transition and creation of jobs. And trade might have really instrumental role in building links, in linking businesses, in promoting certain standards, in implementation of new low emission and energy saving technologies, resource saving technologies. Usually trade follows the legislation, but at the same time trade helps to set the standards. We all remember how many industrial standards, how many consumer standards have been created ahead of legislation. So shaping the behavior of both consumers and other industries might be a very important role for those who are active in trade, for those who are active in shaping trade agreements in a way that they serve the purpose, they help to develop economic strength, they help to develop competitive level playing field, but they also help to implement the standards that environmental agreements introduce, and these standards, well, by the way, help the businesses to survive. Paris concluded 3 years of very intense negotiations, and it's opened the door. So the job is not over. It's just the beginning. And Joe mentioned the first necessary steps that are needed to fully implement what was decided in Paris, but this set of decisions and these provisions that are included in the agreement itself, in the treaty, just build a framework, and what is in the framework needs to be filled with concrete action. With concrete action that would transparently inform the world of our mitigation actions, adaptation, of the technology development, of how much we help to develop capacity of countries to implement, to build new economic structure. And there is a very important tool that will help to strengthen this transparency, which is called global stocktake. This is the tool that Paris Agreement told us to exercise every 5 years and collectively assess what is the kind of response of global climatic system to our actions. What is the result of what we have collectively done? The first global stocktake will happen in 2023. So that's why it is so important to have by 2018 all the transparency framework ready and all the foundation for having the discussion completed. Why we need to do it? Well, very easy task. Keep global warming well below 2 degrees and make everything possible to not to exceed 1.5 rise of global mean temperature. By the way, not by the end of this age, this century, never. We must never exceed this threshold, because if this threshold is exceeded, that probably means the disaster beyond imagination. How to get there? It's not predefined. You know, as a matter of fact, you can compare this further development to pioneers of railways in the Wild West in America. It was a train that carried the rails before the engine, and the people were just building the rails and the train was proceeding. And we are in more or less this situation. We will need to use various pieces of construction material, including our thoughts, and build this way. Luckily, we know where to get. Those guys also knew where to get. They were heading west, and we are heading up not more than 2, best 1.5. Well, I think industry might help, and the trade is quite luckily one of the tools that would help in spreading the good pieces of technology, good pieces of education, good pieces of knowledge that helps. Joe mentioned businesses, financial sector institutions. Yes, indeed, they are the key players in what we call paradigm shift. Because we need to shift development paradigm. We keep repeating this paradigm shift since, I don't know, 3 years ago on every single meeting, and we don't know yet how to do it fully, but we know that adoption of rules and principles of sustainability linked with transparency of action, links with openness to cooperation, should help. And that's why the UN might play such an important role. The UN, which is in fact the only global organization that is recognized by all countries in the world, that is the framework, the platform, the space for negotiating international multilateral treaties, without which we wouldn't be able to build a coherent system that would respond to the needs. And of course, for climate action, we've got United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change with Kyoto Protocol and new Paris Agreement. For trade, we've got WTO and a few others, ILO. But as a matter of fact, the UNFCCC is the convention that has very strong links to businesses. And I probably don't need to convince anybody in this room that this is the case. That even judging of this panel, I can say that the participation of Dirk here is a good proof of the interest of business community in this topic and a few others in this room. But I think it's good to remember that while talking about the environmental impacts, we are debating economic impacts, and we are debating the way the economic transition should proceed. And just single fact, by 2050, the forecast of population growth tells us that we will be 10 billion in the planet. Or at least some of you will be on the planet. And this 10 billion means that the developing countries, some of them would double their population. Africa would probably be a 2 billion people continent. And the majority of this growth will land in cities that would gradually start changing to become mega cities. So just think of Manila times 100, Lagos times 50 on one continent. This causes certain problems, and these problems, if not properly addressed with new technologies that use local indigenous material, with new technologies that help to save water, with new technologies that provide renewable sources of energy, well, that is going to lead to uncontrolled disasters. And that's why, and this is my final point, that's why cooperation between countries is so important. And when talking about sustainable development, the sustainable transition, and its implementation, cooperation is going to be the most desired behavior of countries, but also of all stakeholders. I'll stop here. Thank you.
Fine. Thank you, Tomasz. Jake, you're the lead EU negotiator. I think these folks are somewhat interested as to where the EU is looking to COP22. What are your, if you want, expectations, what do you think can be achieved? Because sometimes you want to be too ambitious, sometimes you don't want to be ambitious enough, and you know, there's a balance. There's only 6 days in the end, and you can't, I'm not sure you change the world in 6 days. You could, but who knows? Jake.
Well, thanks, thanks, Andre, and good evening, everyone. Thanks for the opportunity to say a few words on the issue of climate change and trade, which I understood to be the main topic of the panel today. Which won't touch directly on the APA process, as you've just suggested, or what we might achieve in Marrakech, but may provide a bit more of a historical perspective on where we are with regard to relationship between these two very important policies that are clearly key to what the EU is trying to achieve through multilateral negotiations, not just in discussions of the WTO, but ongoing bilateral discussions on trade, as well as in the Paris Agreement discussions. I think it's important to note, as others have, that the Paris Agreement is part of a process that's been running for more than two decades, 25 years of international negotiations on climate change. And from the very outset, because of the profound transformations that other panelists have described, that people anticipated even back in the 1990s would be necessary to prevent dangerous climate change, to prevent global warming, we would need to use the rules that we developed internationally, use the policies that we're putting in place domestically to transform markets. We would have to have a significant impact on markets. And that would involve countries putting in place measures that would affect the international trade in goods and services if we're going to achieve these collective goals that we've set for ourselves. So the 1992 Framework Convention on Climate Change anticipated that we may need to deploy trade measures in order to achieve climate policy objectives, and set out as a principle that measures taken to combat climate change, including unilateral ones, should not constitute a means of arbitrary or unjustifiable discrimination or a disguised restriction on international trade. And for those of you who know anything about trade law, will know that these words were drawn directly from then, the GATT 1947, in order to ensure that as we made these transformations possible through putting in place domestic policies and by negotiating international treaties, we would take into account the need to comply and conform to these trade rules that we had already agreed. So academics noted that, negotiators noted that, and 25 years later, I think it's fair to say that there hasn't been a major conflict, a major dispute between countries that are being put in place climate policy and those that are invoking trade rules to seek to discipline or to manage those climate policies. And why would that be? There are two possible reasons. One, we have been so prescient and so careful about designing trade rules and designing climate rules that we've managed to produce a system that as we always aspire to do, is mutually supportive in its nature. So as we begin to regulate climate change, as we begin to reduce emissions, as we begin to put in place policies that affect, for example, energy efficiency standards on products, we have managed to do so in a way that is compatible with international trade rules, and so no disputes have arisen. The other explanation is that despite all the rhetoric of transformation, starting in 1992, and you heard some of it in terms of the aspiration of the panelists today, we haven't yet put in place domestic policies sufficiently transformational that we've actually generated a basis for a significant trade friction or trade dispute between, for example, WTO members or other trading partners. Well, let's see which of those two you think, in the course of a conversation that we might have later, explains what's happened. But I do think that we have made significant steps in the climate change space to make sure that we avoid any conflict with trade rules. I think there are basically five chapters or themes within the development of the climate change regime that have attempted to do this. First is that principle that I just cited for you, which, as I said, is included in the Framework Convention and certainly is expected to apply also in the implementation of the Paris Agreement. And I would say describes the way the European Union develops its climate policies. We, of course, would never put in place a policy that affected trade that was in any way arbitrary or unjustifiable or disguised restriction on trade, and we would expect the same of our trading partners. That principle there is in place, and I say would apply going forward with regard to the Paris Agreement, but it implies some specific things about the way in which climate policies should be designed. One is that we should avoid the use of trade bans. The other is, as we put in place policies that may be required to make distinctions between products, that we not do it in a way that's based on the national origin of those products, or if we are distinguishing between products that are otherwise like, that we don't do it in such a way that is arbitrary and justifiable. And you can see policies evolving in this space that might run the risk of raising those kinds of issues. So, for example, when the European Union was considering a way in which creating incentives for consumers to buy fuels that were produced in a way that was less carbon intensive than other fuels, it required us to consider what process and production methods were used to produce those fuels. And so you can see that there can be a policy discourse that might bump up against these principles and therefore would require us to ensure that we were not being arbitrary or unjustifiable in making those distinctions between products that the consumer might otherwise seem to be like products. So that principle exists, it persists, and it will continue to, I hope, guide the development of policies amongst the European Union's trading partners as well as, of course, within the EU. That's a first chapter and a dimension of the relationship between the climate change regime and the trade policy that I think it's important to keep in mind as we move forward. The second was a concern more from the countries that might be impacted by climate policies. And here you may have heard the term the impact of response measures. And again, in the Framework Convention, there is a provision that basically says that we should give full consideration when putting in place policies that are aimed at achieving climate outcomes of the potential impacts of these response measures on other countries. This was primarily a concern all the way back in the 1990s of the petroleum exporting countries that were concerned that if we made a lot of progress rapidly in reducing greenhouse gas emissions, that might mean a lowering demand for the products that they were seeking to export. And so there has been an ongoing conversation in the climate change context around response measures to give assurances to oil exporting countries and to other countries that as we design climate policies, we will take their concerns into account. That has most recently evolved from a conversation about the potential for trade protectionism around climate change into the need to focus more and more on the challenge of economic diversification, recognizing that we all have started this process as economies heavily dependent upon the combustion of fossil fuels, some of us exporters, some of us importers, and together we have to learn how we can go through the transformation, the economic diversification necessary to move us towards these very ambitious objectives that we've set ourselves in Paris to essentially become a fossil-free global economy in the second half of this century. So a forum has been set up under the Climate Change Convention, and it will be continued under the Paris Agreement to deal with this issue of response measures, to continue learning from each other as to how we can do that economic diversification in a way that, as is described in the Paris Agreement's preamble, provides a just transition for all those that may have jobs or other interests that are dependent upon the current fossil fuel-based economy. A third chapter in the relationship between the climate change regime and trade has to do with carbon markets, and a couple of the panelists have already referred to this. When we first established the carbon markets under the Kyoto Protocol, there were some questions as to whether or not some of these trade disciplines that I just mentioned, prohibition on the ban of products, trade in products and services, or ensuring that we don't make arbitrary or unjustifiable distinctions between products on the basis of their national origin or on the basis of their process and production method, would apply to carbon markets. So are the offsets or allowances that are moving across boundaries in international carbon markets subject to the WTO disciplines? And this was relevant to negotiators and to policymakers and to observers because, in fact, one of the first things that we did in designing carbon markets was to make a distinction between offsets that were generated in developing countries, which would be eligible for the issuance of credit under the Clean Development Mechanism under the Kyoto Protocol. We made a decision that only offsets from developing countries would be eligible for that kind of certification. And then you saw different countries, different regions, including the European Union, making distinctions not on the basis of national origin, but on the basis of what they saw were the environmental integrity or quality of those offsets. So arguably a process and production-based distinction between offsets that was being developed in the context of carbon markets. So the question arose, would the WTO disciplines apply to these? And if so, could they prevent us from making those judgments that seem to be essential for effective climate policy, but that might bump up against these disciplines that I just described? I think the way in which that issue has largely resolved, but Dirk may address this as well, is that, in fact, offsets and allowances aren't products or services for the purposes of WTO rules. It may be that they create incentives for the production of particular products. It may be that they create markets for the provision of certain services. But offsets and allowances themselves are regulatory instruments. They're not products or services. So those disciplines don't apply. It will be interesting to see if Joe is right in thinking that we have the potential as a result of the Paris Agreement to have a very growing carbon market that involves many new players than we've had involved in that market before, whether this issue arises again. A fourth chapter in the relationship between climate policy and trade policy is in the area of border carbon adjustments. So as we move to put in place climate policy domestically, there is, of course, the concern that we might create an unlevel playing field between those countries that are moving more quickly to regulate CO2 and other greenhouse gas emissions and those that are moving more slowly. That was true back in 1992 when we had this distinction between the actions of developed countries and the actions of developing countries. And though through that however many letter acronym that Joe just described, we've now moved on to a situation where developing countries are also undertaking obligations, we still expect there to be a very unlevel playing field for the indefinite future in terms of the quality and the robustness of regulations that apply in one jurisdiction as compared to another jurisdiction. And that may tempt, as some countries move to regulate emissions more and more robustly, them to put in place at the border an adjustment that it would take into account a difference in carbon price between the country of origin of a good and the country in which that good would be sold. And we saw these kinds of measures contemplated at early stages of the European climate policy. And when the US was moving a few years ago to put in place a comprehensive national scheme on climate policy, they also included in their proposed legislation the potential to use border carbon adjustments to add an additional cost to products coming from countries that didn't have the same level of regulation as the US did to make that kind of adjustment. So that is a debate that has been around for a while, maybe reinvigorated as a result of the Paris Agreement. And the Paris Agreement doesn't say anything in particular at all about how the climate policymakers might deal with the issue of border carbon adjustments. One issue to keep in mind is that every BCA proposal that I've looked at so far requires policymakers at some point to make an assessment of whether the policies in the country of origin of a particular good are comparable to the policies of the country in which that good would be sold. We have developed, as Joe was describing, this approach where each country designs its own policy. And we've produced a set of INDCs, over 180 of them, that are very, very different in their nature. And so objectively, a policymaker could look at these two different policies and say they are not comparable. Or a policymaker could look at these two policies and say, well, the Framework Convention on Climate Change and the Paris Agreement, according to globally agreed principles, has agreed that each country can nationally determine the level of ambition that it has within its jurisdiction. And therefore, it would be only appropriate for a country to look to see whether an INDC was in place or an NDC was in place in the country of origin, and that would be sufficient for them to be able to determine as to whether or not regulation was comparable in its nature. So that's, I think, a next step of the discussion that we'll see perhaps emerge in the future around border carbon adjustments. Finally, the final chapter of the relationship between climate policy and trade policy, I think, comes in the form of competition to the access, competition for the access to the benefits of the markets that climate policy is beginning to create. So this is the happiest chapter, perhaps, from an interface between climate change policy and trade policy, is that we are seeing that there is this transformation beginning to take place with regard to particular products and services, that industries and countries and companies and economies are beginning to take advantage of the creation of these new markets. You see, for example, the influx of low-cost solar panels entering into the markets here in Europe, but all around the world. And that, of course, triggers a reaction from the domestic industry saying, well, now that we've created these markets, for example, in Europe, created this demand for solar panels, who has priority access to those benefits? And are the trade rules going to be able to help us to ensure that there is a level playing field, at least within Europe, for access to those markets? Or will they stand in the way of governments making the adjustments with their own economies to ensure that their domestic industries have as much access to those markets as those that may be producing those goods overseas? So that's a quick overview of all of the issues. Some of those that panelists have already touched upon, some that I'm sure Ricardo would have addressed had he been here. So I wanted to, in some ways, cover them. And I think the way in which the European Union is looking forward to the next stages of all of these chapters is by, of course, continuing to pursue aggressive and ambitious climate policy here in the EU. Looking for ways to ensure that the playing field is leveled globally with regard to climate policy in our major trading partners, avoiding conflicts with the WTO by, of course, respecting our obligations under that agreement, and doing so by, of course, complying with those rules ourselves, but also looking at ways in which we can continue to use non-trade restrictive policies, such as the behind-the-border policies that we take in the context of the ETS, to ensure that any competitiveness concerns that might otherwise trigger measures like border carbon adjustments are addressed instead through ensuring that our industries are protected against the risks of carbon leakage by using behind the border measures and not measures at the border. So that was rather quick and covered a lot of ground, but I hope it gave both a perspective on the history of climate policy as it relates to trade policy and also the approaches that the European Union has been taking to these issues.
Well, thanks, Jake. We've been joined now. You know, Jake was referring, if Ricardo had been here, well, Ricardo is here now. Ricardo is, of course, the chief executive and the co-founder of ICTSD. I remember in Geneva when I was running AIDA, and I heard of ICTSD, had a few friends there, but we never crossed at that time. But I'm glad that now we have the opportunity to work together under the umbrella of ICTSD, and thank you very much, Ricardo. He had to kind of run and catch a few things today to be here. We'll give him the time to catch his breath, and we'll go to Dirk Forrester. Dirk, first of all, Jake, you've mentioned this word of response measure that is, you know, I've worked closely with Manfred and some of the other negotiators. So between Tomas, who's under whose kind of your umbrella is response measures, I did facilitate that at the last meeting. I think that's quite a fascinating story. I frankly had no idea about this, but I found it an interesting field. And I think it's a field that is gonna grow in time and it's gonna become an important issue for many of us. Dirk, we have worked together for many years. I think you know you've heard a very broad spectrum of things, but you and I have focused on Article 6 to some degree or to a large degree. Many of your members are in this room. So tell us a little bit about your expectation for Marrakech. What do you think is realistic for Marrakech?
Well, thanks, Andre, and it's a pleasure to be with you all and to talk about a subject near and dear to our hearts at AIDA. The provision in Article 6 was really one of the great surprises of the Paris talks, because it appeared late in the game and frankly appeared in a form that was a little more elaborate than we might have expected the negotiators could produce. Yet its future is still related a lot to what Joe described as the new MPG acronym of getting rules and modalities and procedures for how Article 6 will work. And I think Article 6 is important to many of the things that Jake described, because if it works well, it could bring markets together in a way that helps reduce competitive distortions, that could help to promote common prices and giving companies in different jurisdictions access to the same type of pricing. It'll take a while to get there, but that's part of the aspiration, I think, in my membership in supporting these kinds of policies, is a belief that it helps them make the transition in an orderly way, it reduces those competitive distortions, and frankly, it actually creates the dynamics so that you could envision getting to a 2-degree level of protection without dramatic disruption in economies. There'll be some disruptions along the way, but I'm talking about massive things that could actually set climate policy back. So you want something that enables sort of a rational transition. And we think that it's got some hallmarks of a type of a policy that could do that. What Article 6 is sort of about is, you read through it, it doesn't say a lot about markets. It says a little bit about non-markets, but it doesn't use the market word much. It talks about that cooperation word. And it is about cooperation on the business side of things in helping to achieve ambitions, but being able to invest in emission reduction opportunities across borders and being able to create units that might be transferable where a need is greater to another jurisdiction. As we approach the Marrakech COP, first of all, we're extremely grateful that this provision survived and that it appears where it does. I think we also look at the negotiations on this in a slightly different light than maybe they were a long time ago. I think when I started working on climate in the U.S. delegation, we had a whole lot more companies that came because they were afraid we were going to do something stupid. Which we were entirely capable of, but they were afraid that they needed to be there to remind of the concerns they had. Nowadays, I think people see the fear probably is more related to NDC implementation, is what happens on the ground, because it's the actual policy that's being fought about in Canada right now, or in the courts in the United States, or in the halls of the parliament here, that actually is going to affect things. So maybe they look at what the opportunities are in the Paris talks more as maybe something that could actually help. And that would be, if these provisions work well, could they encourage countries to work together on their markets? Could they encourage fungibility of units across borders? Could they inspire the confidence that will draw more finance into this arena? But I think we also approach the negotiations with a bit of humility, in the sense of understanding that some of this is difficult stuff, and frankly, the track record of negotiators is quite mixed on it. As I look back over the time that I've been involved in this issue, I think this is the fourth time that we've tried to design market mechanisms at the UN level. The first was in the Framework Convention, where, and Jake took us back to it, he even has this handy dandy copy here to reference. But the first was in the Framework Convention, where there was a provision that allowed countries to implement activities jointly, right? We called that joint implementation. And the original vision of that was that it would be the underpinning of a tradable permit market for those that were interested in using it. The rules for joint implementation were to be agreed at COP1 in Berlin. How many of you were in COP1? I shouldn't have asked the question. Mm-hmm. So I was at COP1, and the rulemaking didn't go well. We got a pilot phase of joint implementation with no crediting, but if countries or governments sort of wanted to sponsor pilot projects to demonstrate how it would work, they could do so with the understanding that you'd never get credit for it. So you can imagine how many private sector companies volunteered for a JI project. Not too many, only those that got some underwriting from governments for the most part. So fast forward in time, we got to Kyoto, we got elaborated provisions, and a few years later we got Marrakech Accords that actually breathed some life into those provisions. We got an EU ETS that created a market for them. We had Japanese purchasing programs that created a market for them. So that time it actually worked. And negotiators went through the difficult pain of writing down all the details that you needed to make those work. The third example, I guess it was Durban, when we got agreement on a new market mechanism within a framework for various approaches and a non-market mechanism, so there's something for everybody, and I think that was supposed to be agreed at the very next COP in Doha. Unfortunately, we walked away from Doha with gridlock on that topic, so it got forwarded to Thomas to solve in Warsaw. We couldn't get agreement in Warsaw, so it got punted to Lima. By that point in time, everybody's sort of saying, well, you know what, we got Paris coming up, let's just solve it there. So we got to Paris, and by the time we got to Paris, frankly, we would have been happy with a sentence or something that actually acknowledged that markets might be valuable in the future. But instead, we came away with an article that's got some specificity about how it works. It's an article that makes clear that you need good accounting rules, so you avoid double counting, and we think that's vitally important for building confidence in the market. We also got a new mechanism, a sustainable development and mitigation mechanism, that could build on the experiences of the CDM and JI programs of the past and maybe create a kind of a fungible unit in the future. But it's dependent on getting rules at the first meeting of the parties to the Paris Agreement. It says it shall be done at the first meeting. I'm not sure that's possible, because I'm not sure when that meeting is going to be. My suspicion is it's not Marrakech, but it's very possibly the meeting next year. And there's a good bit that would have to be elaborated. And there may be some workarounds on the timing. This thing might stay open for a little while, but I think the business community is actually looking at this now with a, I don't want to say a jaundiced eye, because there's a lot of hope and opportunity around this provision. But there's certainly an understanding that it's risen and fallen a couple of times in the past. So I think the pressure's on negotiators and their chairs to actually deliver on this provision so that we all know what we have to work with. I think it's important for governments to know whether or not they can rely on that mechanism that's sort of outlined in section 6.4. Is it gonna be available? Is it gonna be in business? Is it gonna produce? If they want projects coming through, I don't know, Philippe, how long does it take to get a project identified and do all the paperwork? You gotta get it financed, you gotta order the equipment. It's 3 years, 2 or 3 years. So if you want delivery of units in 2021, business community kind of needs to know what's expected and how it's going to work, more like 2018. So I think the pressure's on to deliver on this provision. Maybe the good news is, though, that parties aren't limited to using that provision this time around. If it gets stalled at the UN level, Japan is already showing us that there's a way of doing crediting mechanisms separate from this that still abides by the accounting principles. So it could be that other countries decide to operate their own. Right now, California and Quebec operate their own offsets program. There's nothing to stop Europe from doing the same thing, but at least that jurisdiction is doing it. And Japan is doing it with something like 17 or 18 different trading partners. So the potential is there. I'm not sure it's as valuable to us in the private sector as having one that works well in a centralized fashion, because the centralized model gives us something that's sort of been a holy grail for a long time, and that's a fungible unit. Fungible meaning that if I make too many of them for one jurisdiction, but I need them in another one, that I can take them there and use them. Or that if I see a better investment opportunity in a project in a different jurisdiction, that I can pursue it. So it just creates a lot more flexibility, and it creates that fungible unit. I think it's still possible to get there through a set of disparate mechanisms that happen more bottom up. But I do, and that may well be where we end up. And if that happens, I'm sure the business community will help find a way to make it work. But I do think that there's some real value in keeping our noses to the grindstone collectively on trying to complete this mechanism on time this time around and have it available at UN level. I think it's also possible that this mechanism can do more than just crediting. I think it's possible that it could produce some very useful MRV tools that countries could use back home. It could develop some standardized baselines that could be used back home. It could deliver a registry that's available for countries that are interested in using it, that puts them into a common registry with other parties. So I think it's got some real potential for that. And I do think, coming back around, that it, at the end of the day, could be a real asset collectively to nations and to their businesses in promoting this cause of fairness, which I think is what I would use as the more positive word about competitiveness concerns. Because at the end of the day, we're looking for a system that business is satisfied with because it's doing its part, but it also feels like its peers are doing their part. And that all begins with the type of visibility and transparency of what's going on and the ability to sort of compare what's happening in one jurisdiction to another. And markets have a handy way of bringing that transparency, because in order to work as effectively as what we've been talking about in this article six, we're talking about a kind of a transparency on accounting that could support market development. And that means that you know who's doing what, that you know what the longs and shorts are in the market, that you know that there are this sort of comparable treatment of industries that are involved in the different systems that might link together. So I think there's a great hope and what this article on cooperation could bring, a great opportunity for businesses. But there's a lot of pressure on the negotiators, and frankly on those of us in the business community and in civil society, to put forward pragmatic ideas about how to take them forward in a useful way. So I think I'll stop there, Andre. I hope that I covered the turf you wanted me to do.
Yeah, thanks, Dirk. And I think that I hope that Ricardo now has caught his breath and kind of running from the airport here. But very, very interesting kind of the discussion that is emerging in terms of the timing and the supply of credits. The question is, does anybody need these things right now? Because I think it's a fair question as well. And if they do, you know, where they're going to emerge from and in what shape. We heard about the Japanese initiative. New Zealand has a New Zealand declaration that is a semi-club of some sort, promoting common standards. So there's a lot of things that are popping up. But what I would like to turn to Ricardo before we can go up down to you and take questions and comments from you. Ricardo?
Well, thank you, Andre, and congratulations for organizing this first roundtable, or this panel of the roundtable, rather. I apologize. I think I should never ever again complain about the traffic in Geneva. It doesn't compare to this. It took me over an hour to get here from the airport, which is incredible. I'm trying to think how could I really add to what you have said here, and I'm really feeling that I missed hearing from the people that really know about this subject. So let me maybe add a couple of words first on ICTSD very quickly, and then on the trade climate nexus that I understand Jake already probably covered extensively. So on ICTSD, we are a 20-year-old organization. Last week we marked the 20 years of launching the organization. We were set up to advance sustainable development through the use of trade and investment policy frameworks. At that time, something very innovative. Today, something that is, sustainable development, very mainstream, at least as a concept, if not the words. But at that time, quite groundbreaking and innovative. Last week, looking at the work that we have been doing since then, I browsed through the first and the second issue of our main, sort of our flagship publication, and one of the titles I found in November of 97 already was reads Kyoto Climate Summit, Emissions Trading, Other Key Issues Still Unresolved. This was reporting on the Bonn preparatory meeting for the Kyoto conference, and when you read through it, you can't but feel that it's been a very long time trying to resolve many of these issues, very much in the same with the same ideas, with the same approaches that we're trying today, with some significant political, in some very significantly different political context, rather. But so we've been following a number of themes, of which the most important one is to ensure that action on climate is supported by trade policy at the international level, understanding that frameworks for trade particularly determine allocation of and use of resources in a globalized economy, understanding that action on climate will probably result in shifts in the terms of trade, in relative prices, as they probably should, if we really do things correctly, and therefore making sure that the trade policy, investment policy, the frameworks that we have at the multilateral level and at regional levels are supportive of the climate objectives. The most important thing, obviously, is trying to engage the policy communities on constructively in working together. After 20 or so years, it's still not the case that there is really a smooth communication between the various policymakers, and so you still have different language that it's spoken in the various forum of negotiation, and the crafting of rules is not necessarily coherent. So that's a very big concern behind the work that we do. That speaks to a number of specific areas. I heard you mentioned response measures. I think Jake talked about them. It's been one of the areas that we're more have always been more interested in, particularly because it also speaks about the growth concerns and of developing countries, and we need to again make sure that the way in which we design climate action measures is done in such a way that it doesn't end up in perverse effects. Because it again threatens livelihood, threatens economic development models, and so on. There's some, as I said, more specific issues that have to do now that we have the type of regime that comes out of Paris, have to do with ensuring that as we get measures taken by countries at very different levels of ambition and a larger variety of measures. We make sure, again, that competitiveness concerns are also taken care of in a way that it's enabling of climate action rather than working against climate action. We need to ensure that the targets that are in Paris, for instance, with respect to, that will call for a transformation of the energy matrix are supported by policies that will support that transition to clean energy technologies. That's still a very steep sort of ambition. And if we want to get to the 2-degree stabilization targets, we'll need to shift massively into clean energy technologies. It's happening in a way that has surprised us all, but it's still not at the pace that it should happen. And a lot has to do with barriers, both sort of traditional border barriers, as well as non-tariff barriers, and other types of measures that affect the development of those technologies, the adoption, the dissemination of the technologies, particularly in a globalized economy where you have a fragmented organization of production, where different countries produce different type of components that are crossing jurisdictions several times before they become equipments for clean energy technology, for instance, and are installed in their final destination. So there's a great deal of work that has to be done there. We have been championing what we call a sustainable energy trade agreement that looks at all the measures on trade and investment that would make this transition to clean energy technology a more efficient and a faster one. Governments are engaged, and probably I imagine Jake talked about this. They're engaged in a negotiation to liberalize tariffs on a set of environmental goods in the WTO that will include a good number of the type of components that are necessary for clean energy as well as for energy efficiency. So that's a first step. It has taken a great deal of effort. It's still very modest. It needs to be complemented by tackling other measures, agreements that would tackle the non-tariff measures, as well as try to deal with the 21st century economy of the servicification of the clean energy industry, the dealing with services embedded in those technologies, and so on. So it's a more complex area than what has been, for the moment, what the policy communities in the trade field have been able to grasp and start really working on in a purposeful manner. Then there are a number of new issues that are coming out of research that get us into a better understanding of the transition to low carbon. One of those concerns that we have is with respect to embedded carbon, and so the notion that you may mitigate emissions in, for instance, the production of goods in a domestic economy, but you may be substituting for embedded carbon that is imported in goods that your economy needs. In the sort of the state of the art research on this, we now know, and this is very new, that about a quarter of emissions in the global economy are emissions that are actually imported as embedded carbon. Now, acting on those emissions would need policies that tackle consumption patterns, and it needs a different type of approach. It needs also to understanding exactly what can be done so that you can do it in ways that it's constructive, that leads really to an effective reduction in emissions, and within the current frameworks again for trade and investment on these issues. So that's another type of concern we have on Article 6 and the question of emission trading schemes, the thinking forward into a future where you may go into linking emission trading schemes, something that now seems perhaps more and more possible. We are also and have been interested for many years in on the issue of the legal frameworks that will cover that linkage at the multilateral level. And we believe very strongly that it shouldn't be sort of reinventing the wheel. The world should be able to borrow from what we have, if not use the kind of infrastructure and institutional and in respect of regulatory frameworks to deal with those upcoming issues. So these are just very quickly some of the issues around the carbon trade policy, investment policy, nexus. There's much more. The way in which we work, we engage in brokering knowledge and analysis and research, as well as bringing together policymakers with those that have that knowledge and try to crack solutions to these issues and then advance them in the different fora. And that's why we're very happy with this initiative and support Andre in this effort. So maybe I'll just stop here.
Thank you very much, Ricardo. And it still has a title of COP22. Now, I remember working in Geneva with a bunch of people across the lake from you with Mercuria Energy Trading, and two Swiss guys that owned the company, and they used to pay my trip to these negotiations. And I would come back home, and I remember Marco saying, so what happened? And so what do we do now? And what kind of influence this has on what we do? And I had kind of a hard time to explain to him because I tried to tell them about the Africans and the Latins doing this and that. He said, this is very interesting and very folkloric, but what does it mean for me in business? And especially for him, he's a short-term thinker, he's a trader, and his strategy changes every 20 minutes. So my question would be to you, how do you feel about this? Is this relevant to you, or this is a bunch of people that, we're having a very interesting intellectual debate? It will come down to you at some point, but would like to hear from you now and what you heard about the mix between carbon pricing, the mix between response measure, translated in your language to some degree, carbon leakage and free allocation. These are things that they do flow to you. Maybe they're not apparent right away because they're very esoteric in different language, but they will impact EU policy. And the question is, how do you feel about it? Because you've got the head negotiator here, but a bunch of other people who are running the process, and one guy that is working for many of you trying to influence the process. So would like to hear from you. There is a microphone somewhere. Vinant has a microphone, and would like to give you the floor. We got at the back there of Femke, at the back. So Femke de Jong from Carbon Market Watch.
Yes, thank you. And thank you for this very interesting debate. At least I found it very interesting. I think one of the things we heard a lot was around transparency and accountability to make the Paris Agreement, but also Article 6 a success. And I think one can draw links here also with trade agreements and sort of the lack of public support for trade agreements, at least here in Europe, which is partly, I guess, also due to this lack of transparency and accountability. And also, when we look at EU's climate policies, for example, under the EU ETS, at this moment, there is no transparency about which companies buy to which offsets, which makes it very difficult for stakeholders like us to hold companies accountable for the type of offset credits that they buy. And another thing I think that was mentioned quite often is around linking emissions trading systems, for example. And also there, what we have seen recently, earlier this year, the linking agreement between the EU's carbon market and the Swiss carbon market has been initialed, which means it has been concluded. And we have felt that also this process has not been transparent, has therefore also not been accountable to citizens and other stakeholders. And when we have asked, requested access to this linking agreement that has been initialed, we were denied access. So my question, at least to the speakers, would be how to overcome this in the future. If we want to make Paris Agreement, but also the use of markets to implement our climate policies a success, How can we ensure that there is truly this element of transparency and accountability, not only for companies, but also for citizens at large? Thank you.
Thanks, thank you. I'll take a couple of questions, and then we'll come back. Zolt is somebody that I work with closely on another project on Klima East and some work we're doing in Ukraine. Zolt?
Thank you very much. Although I will raise these things with another hat, which is more of a research interest in this respect or an auditor interest. After a bit of a frustration of with the last 20 years or so, I now realizing by listening to you that we might be all barking up the wrong tree, because the Paris Agreement seems to be a fundamental economic target or a societal target of moving towards 2 degrees. This is by no means an environmental goal. And if we assume, and tell me if I'm wrong with that assumption, but I think that is what all the scientists are saying with respect to the 1.5 degree, is that if we are not eliminating very quickly fossil subsidies, talking about hundreds of billions, if we are not getting into an extremely strong support for the technologies which are making this transition, which is by definition disruptive, and which I guess the WTO is discussing under the Environmental Goods Agreement for the last couple of years, and thirdly, we are not really looking at under embodied or embedded carbon, which is basically the way how we can pretend that, well, we reduce our emissions, but someone else is actually emitting all those things instead of us, we never reach the 2 degree target. So if this assumption is correct, then it feels that the left side of the table from this look has far more to do under trade and economics, whilst obviously the Paris discussions on the rule books and all the modalities and procedures are absolutely fundamental, but without the fundamental economic change, which I mentioned with three elements of getting rid of fossil fuels and getting rid of the subsidies is one step on that. Getting an extreme active promotion, which is against the WTO rules for green technologies, and addressing embodied carbon, we are just not going to resolve this problem. And I would be just very interested on your views on how this is going to happen, or how the WTO or the convention discussions would change on this. Thank you.
Okay, we'll go, since you have that, why don't you give Daniela, Carol, why don't you give it to Daniela since he's here, and then we'll go to John Cooper, and then we'll go to Karsten.
Hello, I'll be very brief. I'm the head of low carbon policies for the ENA group, and my question is very short, and I'd like to get feedback from all the panel. What are your expectations on the role of trade in COP22 Marrakech? So it's written there, and I think it's pretty simple. On the 21st of November, as I'm going to be taking my flight back to Rome, what will be the outcome of COP22 on trade, which I think it's CBAs and mechanisms? Nothing, engagement, a little bit. It would be very helpful for, I think, the private sector to know what your own personal expectations on this.
Caro, there's a gentleman behind there, because let's go that way, yeah, and then we'll walk that way.
Okay. Thanks very much. Dara Conway of Climate Focus. Maybe just to go to the other side of the gentleman's question was then, on one hand, we're looking at expectations for trade in the climate agreement, but it was briefly touched on by Jake and by Ricardo. Expectations for what, you know, the trade regime can do for the climate. So one interesting thing was, of course, there's still plenty of barriers to trade in low carbon goods and services. Environmental goods agreement is a great first step, as Ricardo mentioned. What would be perhaps the panel's expectation? What are the next steps? So what's the next big priority after the environmental goods agreement is completed, hopefully this year, for liberalizing trade in environmental goods and services, you know, both tariff and non-tariff barriers?
And if you want to go to John Cooper, who I think has a few interesting concerns because he fuels Europe. So
thank you, Andre. And can I just say to start off, thank you very much for creating the forum. Congratulations on the round table. I think it's an excellent idea and looking forward to continuing the dialogue. So I speak for Fuels Europe, petroleum refining, but also we are one of many energy intensive industries in Europe that have as a particular concern carbon leakage protection. And I'd like to address a question in particular to Jake, but any of the other panelists that also may wish to comment. We are facing the development of the carbon market in Europe. The carbon market is inherently sensible. We think a carbon market is exactly the right approach. But we also face the prospect that there is a loophole for the ETS, and the loophole is make your goods outside of Europe. And of course, the current system for addressing that is the free allowance system, that is carbon leakage protection. But we are looking at an increasing carbon price, and to get to our 2050 goals, we will need a much higher carbon price. And we also have a system of decreasing free allowances. And so the carbon cost to energy intensive industries is going up and up. These industries we will need for decades. Cement, steel, aluminium, fertilizers, all of these different industries, as well as jet fuel, diesel, gasoline. My question is, what is the future as we go towards these much higher costs? You've mentioned border carbon adjustments. That's a surprise to many that that actually comes back on the table. But it's also something that has fraught with so many problems. Yet, the current system of carbon leakage protection with free allowances has to come to an end or has to be diminished at some point. Are there any other options? What is the future? The energy intensive industries really need to know to plan their strategies. Thank you.
Okay, and Carsten Neuhoff here, Wittwein, and do you want to go to Carsten? And then we will come back to the panel and take comments and reactions to what they heard.
Carsten Neuhoff, I'm the German Institute for Economic Research. And following up on this question, I think it is a challenging dimension in terms of basic materials. Their production is the dominant share of emissions in our industrial sectors. And so coming to Tomasz, you pointed out the need to get to the consumers, whether industrial consumers of materials or final consumers. How do we get the carbon price to these actors in the value chain? Or Ricardo, you said we need the policy framework, the investment framework, such that new innovative materials can find their space. So the question to the international panel, the strategy we are running right now in Europe, which might be a good strategy, is to move to a global development of carbon prices and have major trading partners reducing the free allowance allocation. I think if that works out, if China goes down this road, then we can more and more have the carbon price embedded in commodities and therefore get the response. But how do we make this a tangible vision, make it close enough to reality, such that we have cooperation on this approach, such that we have a timeline, let's say 2021, let's see how the national schemes are implemented across the globe. And if by 2021 we don't see such an implementation, such a strategy, how do we then develop now already the alternatives to make sure we have a framework that allows innovation to succeed in Europe?
Well, thank you very much for this. I think that, we do have an issue because also Justin's going to join us and he's also have a very short window. So, well, Jake, if we start from that side and work down the table, you heard some of the comments. For me, I started doing this negotiation markets and I ended up in response measures because I felt they were in some way the flip side of that. Because there is also an impact, and I see that we're nationalizing dealing with carbon leakage. That's what we do. We agree free allocation at the national level of the, you know, whether it's the EU or Australia or New Zealand or whatever it is, Korea. But at some point, you're going to run out of the stuff because, you know, the curve goes down and things, and we want to do 90%. So I'm looking at, you know, cooperative approaches. Is there a way of cooperating in the future and making sure this tension between that you mentioned between the discipline of WTO, if you want to trade, and UNFCCC and climate change is being addressed? But you've heard some of the other comments.
Thanks. And there were a lot of questions that raised many, many issues, and I can't possibly respond to all of them. But let me try to touch on a few. One was the issue with regard to transparency of European climate policy, but transparency more broadly in the context of carbon markets. I can say, first of all, that whenever there is a state-to-state negotiation that contains a significant dimension of commercial interest, there's always a degree of protectiveness in terms of governments' positions. And in the course of a negotiation of something as sensitive as the linking between the EU and the Swiss carbon trading scheme, there is, of course, a need to keep some of that information confidential amongst the negotiators. With regard to the transparency of climate policy and whether we're delivering on it overall. I think that the EU is second to none in terms of showing ton per ton how it is that we're complying with our targets. And that's part because of the ETS and the way in the ETS allows us to track the emissions of individual installations. But it's part because the EU overall has a commitment to engaging stakeholders in the design of policy, but also in ensuring that the information associated with our regulatory instruments is publicly available. The third dimension of transparency, which I think also was implied in your comments, has to do with the way in which any offsets are generated from the first place. So how do we ensure, if we develop an instrument like the Clean Development Mechanism under Article 6 of the Paris Agreement, how do we ensure that the offsets, that the process by which offsets are generated by any particular project are produced in a way that's transparent and accountable, not just to the international community, but also to the communities that might be affected by those. And we've been working very hard. A lot of the language, I think as Dirk implied, in Article 6 with regard to environmental integrity is there because of EU concerns and priorities, and an essential aspect of environmental integrity is transparency. I'm happy to maybe during the break talk to you more about why I think that stakeholders have a unique opportunity to engage in the design of European Union climate policy and where you continue to be frustrated or disappointed clearly in some aspects of that. The question, which was in the title of the event, what are the expectations with regard to trade for Marrakech? I think one of the reasons you didn't maybe get a clear answer is because there are different views on what the word trade means. On this panel. Some people immediately go to trade in terms of carbon markets. And there, you know, we're in the process, as Dirk explained, of negotiating the rules as to how Article 6 under the Paris Agreement might work. I wouldn't expect any clear deliverables from Marrakech. They're not scheduled to be delivered in Marrakech. We're really just starting those negotiations. So you might have an initial exchange of views, some submissions from parties, but not a clear answer to that. The second is with regard to trade as I addressed it, which is what is the relationship between climate policies and trade rules? There again, I don't think there's going to be a significant discussion around that. There will be some discussion on response measures, which is one dimension of that issue, but no specific outcome scheduled for Marrakech. The third way to understand trade is how is what we're doing in Marrakech influencing the development of international trade in climate-friendly goods, climate-resilient goods. And there, I would hope you would expect to see a lot in Marrakech, not from the negotiators, but because we have this second stream, the non-negotiating stream, that happens now at each COP, where we invite the private sector to come in and to demonstrate, in some ways in the form of a trade fair, but other in terms of the way in which they're trying to encourage us to develop policies that are more friendly to the development of new industries and new sectors. And there's going to be a lot of activity. A lot of companies are expected, whether they're providing goods or services. And there, hopefully, we will be sending a signal that what Paris means is a transformation of markets and the need for more trade in climate-friendly goods and services. I didn't want to imply in my run through the history of trade policy that the issue of border carbon adjustments is something that the EU is seriously considering. As I made the point when I mentioned it, we are using behind the border measures, not at the border measures, to address competitiveness concerns. That doesn't mean that competitiveness isn't going to be increasingly important. It is. And for a jurisdiction that has a 2050 roadmap that's pretty much in line with the level of ambition that we set out for ourselves in Paris in terms of decarbonization in the second half of this century, in order to maintain the level of support for that kind of ambitious policy, we have to be addressing competitiveness concerns. The main way I see the Paris Agreement is doing that is, first of all, setting very ambitious targets, and then clearly indicating that those are collective targets. The goal in Paris is to peak globally as soon as possible. The goal set in Paris is to ensure that we are all carbon neutral in the second half of this century. And that means ensuring that all countries, all members, take that obligation seriously and are demonstrating their progression towards those goals through the regular updating of their commitments, as Joe described. That's the main way in which we're dealing with competitiveness concerns, is by ensuring that other countries are taking on board serious commitments as well. And that's how we'll make sure that embedded carbon is something that's being dealt with across jurisdictions and not just by the unilateral acts or measures of one country.
Thanks. What I'll do is I'll skip through executive decision because Joe has a dinner with the New Zealand ambassador. So, Joe, do you want to go?
Yes, apologies for having to run. And heaps of questions. I'm going to just make a few incredibly quick comments. So apologies if they're a little bit too truncated. First on transparency, I think that by comparison with trade negotiations, for good reasons and for different reasons, the negotiations on climate change are pretty transparent. Not totally, but pretty transparent. And the other transparency comment I wanted to make was that there will be an important relationship between international obligations created through and elaborated through the Paris Agreement and domestic policy. They won't be exactly the same, but they will be, as a result of the post-Paris work programme, aligned. And I think that will help from a business perspective and an outsider perspective get that transparency relationship better. I also think, building on Jake's comment, that you're starting to see a virtuous circle, that Paris sent a very clear signal to business, to cities, to the world, really, that governments do mean business on climate change and are prepared to act, that in return, business is starting to send signals back to government that they too are up for the challenge and prepared to take action. So that so-called action agenda, the trade fair component of the COP, I think is going to grow in significance and importance. Couldn't agree more about phasing out fossil fuel subsidies, especially those that are identified as inefficient, so that you're getting pricing signals right and creating, ensuring that the playing field isn't tilted against renewable energy. Two last comments. The role of COP, of trade in COP22, the outcome there on trade, I think, as Jake said, it'll be engagement rather than a formal decision. And I won't elaborate any further because I think he answered that question really well. And on the development of carbon markets, I think I said in my opening comments that the large number of INDCs that referred to the potential to use market measures, market mechanisms, suggests that this will grow, and we're seeing it certainly in my part of the world around the Asia Pacific. It is growing very rapidly, and the introduction of a nationwide carbon market in China by next year is going to be hugely significant on that front. But it won't be a neatly developed thing. It will come from the bottom up rather than us agreeing on a global price on carbon. Thanks.
Dirk, we'll continue down.
Sure. Thanks, Andre. And I guess I'm glad Joe mentioned the Chinese ETS, which we're sort of awaiting hearing more details about how it's going to operate. But thinking back on this trade issue, my experience in the U.S. is that the trade concern was often a euphemism for whether China was doing anything or not, right? And so really, maybe that's the answer to the big question about, concerns in Europe, is whether China's program is serious or not. I can tell you that when Daniela and I were in China earlier in the year, and you have sort of sidebar conversations with companies in China, they're asking the same thing about whether their competitors in different provinces are going to be treated equally as they're treated, right? So the same issues come up everywhere. I was in South Korea last week, and still a concern. And again, I think it is one of the great things about a trading policy that can help homogenize some of that and reduce some of the concerns. May not solve everything, but I think it's part of what's important. So my answer to Daniele's question was going to be that probably the most important thing happening on the role of trade is what happens in China this year, as opposed to what happens in Marrakech. But I do think Marrakech is going to be an opportunity for all of us to look negotiators in the eye and see how serious they are about follow through and whether they're serious about their deadlines. And And frankly, in the market stuff in Article 6, I've come away with believing that so there's going to be submissions on all this stuff later this month, right? So we'll get to see a little sneak preview of what countries are thinking and different groups of countries are thinking. And I've decided that the key thing to look for is how many of them are asking the same questions, right? How many common questions do you have versus all of the outliers? And that would actually be progress if they could agree on the same list of questions that they need to resolve in the rules that they come up with. And on transparency, I was just going to, you know, I think we probably have a lot of common views on, you know, more information is always better. But I am quite sensitive to the fact that when you are in a trading policy world, Jake's comment was spot on that some of it's market sensitive, and so you have to be very careful about that. I also think about, like, what examples. Probably one of the most transparent governments on this stuff anywhere is in California. And I sometimes wonder if it's too transparent, just because if you actually have to go through the gauntlet of how many stakeholder engagement processes they have, it's really intense. But it is a place where we do get lots of opportunities for input, formally and informally. But I think it's just sort of the California way. So it might be one to look at. Thanks.
Thank you, Andre. Just very quickly and sort of telegraphic as well. I think the key issue, and I'm just picking up from the various questions here, the key issue is how do we deal with the variety of measures that are expected to come out of the NDCs under the Paris Agreement? And then I think you were right when you pointed out to how this is, at the end of the day, about the management of the global economy and ensuring again that the growth engines in the global economy are not slowed down, but that they respond again to the concerns on climate and that they lead the transformation leads really to the kind of outcomes that we need in climate. So, what that would require, I think, is that the trade regime and the climate regime work as one, if you like, with the same purpose. And we're far from there in many ways. So sort of the good news is that, yes, we're doing something on the environmental goods, but it's very modest. It's important. It's incredibly modest, just in against the kind of needs that we have and against the barriers that we're facing and the issues, the policy issues that are involved there, and it's more irritating, if you like, because we have the instruments. So it's a question really of gathering the political will and really catalyzing the sense of emergency that has come in bringing some outcome in Paris on climate, but bringing it to the other, again, to the other regime, to the trade regime. I'm absolutely convinced that without that, we're not going to make much more progress. Another example of this is someone mentioned the fossil fuels. We have the instruments in the WTO to deal with them. They're not perfect as they exist today. They need to be worked out better. We ourselves are convening from Monday a process with delegates in Geneva that is looking at the possibility of doing something within the next 18 months that responds to the call for phasing out the fossil fuels and using again the WTO legal infrastructure to do that. But it hasn't been done, and it hasn't been done, I think, out of again a sense of urgency. That something has to bring these regimes and some action on this together. Finding this agreed framework for emissions trading, for carbon taxes, for border measures, making use of subsidies, standards, government procurement, intellectual property, as we have it today, in the interest of climate action, that takes really purposeful, again, action on the part of governments. And without that, I don't think we're going to see a successful implementation of the Paris Agreement. That's really how I see this.
I
And we welcome Jos. Thank you for taking the time. Jos, maybe we'll invite you up here. So other than that, I know that you have a short time frame. So if I wait this whole troop to move there, then by that time you'll be gone. So join us here. We'll get Thomas the floor and then, yeah.
Well, colleagues, well, I'm double privileged. I had Joe next to me, and now I have Jos. Colleagues, I think it's very important to say... Okay, now it's better? Good. First, I think it's very important to say that trade is not about carbon trading only. Trade is about all relations between suppliers and customers, between suppliers along the whole value chain. And along value chain, we can create real change that would help to address climate challenges. So that's first observation. Secondly, and well, looks like Daniela, you are the most popular here because everybody is addressing you. I think that when talking about Marrakech results that hopefully will be significant and equally important as the tasks ahead of us, we need to say that what Jake and Joe called engagement, I would call interaction between businesses and governments will need to take place. If we are to properly assess the impacts of the decisions, we need the contribution, the information, and hopefully encouragement even to do more, because it's private sector, it's business who develops technologies, who provides products. And, well, I would even risk saying that as 20, 30 years ago, army was driving the technology, now it's climate and environment. These are the two challenges, sectors that set standards that that help to introduce new products. And these new products quickly get their place in the market, sometimes with, well, invisible hand, for instance, of the European Commission that help to, for instance, introduce good sources of light that are energy efficient. So energy efficiency, resource efficiency, these are the challenges of the future. There would be the solutions. And talking about the COPs, we had a fantastic discussion in Paris 2 days ago in BIEC, and I heard something, well, some of you were there as well, and that was fantastic idea of having, along with COPs, kind of festival, kind of climate expo organized by business, proposed by business, filled by business with new ideas, new products, and maybe that might also be the way to underline the role of business in climate action. Thank you.
Okay, well, look, I think that probably it's more appropriate that we take a pause now and we move over to the cocktail area, and then Jos will, and Ricardo will say a few words, but I think that this is the formal part, if you want, is completed here. I think it's better that we move there, and again, thank you very much all for this. We have a number of other things coming up, the classics, if you want, the ETS and ESR on 10 and October, 11 of October, but discussion on governance, discussion on trade also coming up later. So again, thank you very much, and I invite you all to be there and thank the panelists.